What's going on, guys, and welcome to the next Crack a Pack episode. Today we are opening up, I believe for the first time on the series, a pack of Mirrodin. This is a fantastic set, a lot of really good cards. Sitting at the top of the value train, we have Chalice of the Void, right around $60 for an original print. At $40 we have Chrome Mox, and then just below that at $28 we have Mesmeric Orb, along with a wealth of other fantastic cards. So hopefully we get something really cool in this. As always, we're going to go through this as if it was a limited environment, so we'll actually read through all the cards and see what we would actually pick in a draft one, pack one, pick one scenario. I will go ahead and say I'm not great at drafting, and I've never drafted Mirrodin. So if you disagree with me or anything like that, please feel free to roast me in the comment section. That's perfectly fine. But our first comment here, Skyhunter Cub. It is a 2/2 for 3. As long as it's equipped, it gets +1/+1 and has flying. Just for a little bit of context for anybody who didn't play during this time, equipments and really just artifacts in general were heavy overplayed in this set. The full block was really just based off of artifacts on the plane of Mirrodin. So it makes sense. A lot of things have a lot of artifact synergies. This card is perfectly fine, actually. I really like this card. A 2/2 that can potentially get +1/+1 in flying is fantastic. If you run equipments, which you probably will run one or two of them, then that card is just great. So I'm actually not too unhappy to see that. Kark Clan Grunt is a 2/2 for 3 as well, and you can sacrifice an artifact and it gets +1/+0 and gains first strike until end of turn. Not as big a fan with this card. I like the Skyhorn Cub better, so I'll put that to the side. Aether Spellbomb is a 1 cast artifact. You can pay a blue and sacrifice it to return a target creature to its owner's hand. You can also pay one and sacrifice it to draw a card. I actually really like the spell bombs in this set. These are just kind of filler, but they're always just playable, right? Like, they always cycle for a card, and then they usually have some kind of useful effect as well. So, actually not unhappy to see that either, though I think I'd rather have the Skyhunter Cub at this point. Nerok Spy is a 2/2 for 3. It's unblockable as long as the defending player controls an artifact, and again, most likely they will. There are a number of decks that maybe don't run a high artifact count, but generally they're probably going to have at least a few. This card's fine. I think I'd still rather have the Cub, though. The reason being, it deals more damage and is evasive if you control an equipment. Yes, it's a little bit more like you have to have the equipment, not just a random artifact, and your opponent, it's not... I think the key is that you can build off of this card. You're not dependent on your opponent, and that's kind of why I like it. So, Nerok Hoversail is an artifact equipment for 1. The equipped creature has flying, and its equip cost is 2. I don't like this as far as the equipment goes. It's not that great, though I will say it's okay filler. Equipment just in general seems to be okay filler, and in this set probably more than any other. It's really easy to get in, equip this to some really, really big bomb, like a 5/5 or something like that, that can normally only swing on the ground, and then actually give it flying and just win the game that way. So by no means do I think this is a bad card. It's a little bit situational, but for that reason, I'm not going to pick that first. Dross Prowler is a 2/1, for 3 with fear, so, very evasive. Not a bad card. It's a little bit filler, in my opinion. I think it's fine, but it's not amazing. So I will probably not pick that. Volshock Gauntlets, artifact equipment, for 2. Equipped creature gets +4/+2 and doesn't untap during its controller's untap step. You can then equip it for 3. This is sort of an interesting card. It's basically kind of removal. You can equip, I believe, your opponent's creature with this after they've sort of attacked, and then you just... it just stays tapped. It doesn't untap. So, like, I think this is a fine card. I don't know if it's better than the Cub, to be honest. It might be, so I'll put it here for now. All Strike is an instant for 1 white. The next time target creature would be dealt, would deal damage this turn, excuse me, prevent that damage, you gain life equal to the damage prevented this way. These are exactly the kind of cards I do not like in Limited. It's just a preventative effect. It stalls you for a turn, which generally is not really where you want to be in Limited. You want to be either stabilizing or swinging the board back in your favor as quickly as possible, and a card like this really just delays. So for that reason, do not like it at all. Galvanic Key is an artifact for 2. You may play, anytime you could play an instant, And then pay 3 and tap it and untap target artifact. This might have some synergies in this set. I'm honestly not super sure. I would say if you had a card that this pairs with, this probably isn't actually all that bad. But I will say it seems like kind of a dead 2-drop a lot of the time, so I probably wouldn't want to play it. Seething Song is an instant for 2 and a red, and you can add 5 red to your mana pool. This is obviously a great card in constructed play, but I would say in limited, probably not the best. I don't think it's very good. There's really nothing that you're going to be able to do with this that's that amazing, in my opinion. Nirok Familiar is a 1-1 for 2. It has flying, and when it comes into play, reveal the top card of your library. If it's an artifact card, put it into your hand. Otherwise, put it into your graveyard. I actually really like this card. I think it's pretty sweet. Most oftentimes, we'll be able to replace itself. Again, you're going to have a pretty high artifact count. But sometimes you'll have to put something in the graveyard. It's okay. It's not great. And so for that reason, I don't know. I don't think it beats what we already have, to be honest, but I do like that card. Talisman of Unity is an artifact for 2. This is part of a cycle. You can tap these to add 1 to your mana pool, and then each one has 2 colors that they can actually play. In this case, it's green or white, and it deals 1 damage to you. For that reason, I think it's fine. It's not amazing. These are pretty good in decks as filler cards. So I would probably not first pick it, but it's not bad. Creeping Mold is 2 and 2 green for a sorcery. Destroy target artifact, enchantment, or land. This is basically just removal in this set. Again, artifacts are everywhere, so you're going to be able to target something with it. For that reason, I actually really like that, and I kind of think that beats what we already have, so I'll put that here. Nuisance Engine is an artifact for 3. You can pay 2 and tap it to put a 0/1 pest artifact creature token into play. This card is hilarious, but not very good in my opinion. Yes, you spit out a little token every turn, and if you're playing something like an equipment deck, you can actually really, really do some cool stuff with it. But for it just doesn't seem to do all that much. Most of the time, it's just going to be a chump blocker, so I kind of don't like it. Tower of Murmurs is our rare. It's an artifact for 4. You can pay 8 and tap it. And target player puts the top 8 cards of his or her library into his or her graveyard. This is obviously hugely, hugely strong. There are a lot of reasons to play this. If you're going to be milling your opponent, that's great. And this card kind of does it by itself. 8 cards in limited is a very, I mean, that's a high amount. That's almost a quarter of the deck right there. I don't know that I really like it, though. With 8 that you have to pay to actually have that effect, it just seems a little bit too high for me, so I probably wouldn't play that. To be honest, it's probably just Creeping Mold. I think this card is great. Destroy target artifact. You're going to have a lot of targets for that. And then, of course, you can have an enchantment or land in there as well if you needed to. It's a little bit more flexible. So for that reason, I'd probably pick the Creeping Mold. But by all means, tell me in the comment section if you disagree. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please make sure to leave a like or a comment down below. And as always, make sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of our content. But with that, I'm going to get out of here. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I will see you in the next Crack a Pack video.